I am Charmel McMillan, and this is the 90th episode of Just One Thing, my show about life-changing moments, life-defining moments, those things that shape not only who we are, but how we see the world around us and where we fit into the grand scheme of things, where purpose and destiny collide. And so the show is titled after my best-selling book, Just One Thing, Foreword by Mike Epps. Thank you guys for helping it sell out 4 times. I appreciate you. And so I've had over 89 guests before tonight from all over the world. We got people coming in from Munich, Germany, live from Munich this Saturday. Tomorrow night, I have another amazing guest. I'm not going to announce him yet because I'm waiting on something, but we have another amazing guest coming tomorrow night. Anyway, tonight, I have amazing R&B singer, songwriter, producer, engineer. She's totally independent, plays multiple instruments, just like a walking gift. And so please welcome IAMCJ. How you doing, love?
Thank you. I'm doing all right. I really appreciate you for inviting me and having me. It's a pleasure. I'm excited and just thankful to, you know, be a guest on your platform. So thank you, Miss Charmel.
Well, thank you, Miss CJ, for coming.
Hey, it's destined because both of our names start with C-H-A-R.
Yeah. I was like, she's Shara, I'm Char.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah, so I haven't met too many people with a name close to mine. This is 26 years for me having an entertainment and sports management company. So wow, it's a pleasure to meet you. I know, right? Hopefully I don't look like what I've been through.
Yeah, I know that's right. Look.
So I always start off, I call them conversations, talking about where you're from, your childhood, the formative years, your family structure. What was all of that like? Because I think that sets the foundation for how we initially see the world, and then we maybe reshift and shift gears depending on what we went through. But where are you from, and what was your family like growing up, and what was little CJ like?
Man, I'm from Little Rock, Arkansas, born and raised part of my life in Little Rock, but then moved a little bit on to the north of it, which is just a few minutes outside in Jacksonville. Mm-hmm. Came mm-hmm. up there, graduated there, went to college in Jonesboro, going back up north, you know, mm-hmm. and, you know, came back on back to the 501, came back this way after college, but little CJ was a little musical tomboy. I mean, I have like 4 brothers, like my whole family is music oriented, and mm-hmm. I mean, you know, people say it all the time, it's just something that you kind of like, as far as music go, it's just something mm-hmm. that for the most part you just kind of, it's in you, you know what I mean? Like these days music tend to be a little bit different, but it's cool. But yeah, I've always done music since I was a little girl. And, you know, it's just something that everybody in my family is musically inclined. So,
okay. So, are you the only girl with 4 brothers?
I am the only girl out of 4 brothers. I am.
Wow. My mom is the only girl has 5 brothers. And wow. You mentioned Little Rock. When I was an engineer, most people don't know I was a professional engineer first. All my degrees and master's degrees and all that is engineering. I don't know how God decided I was supposed to be in entertainment. But my first business trip was to Little Rock, Arkansas.
Oh, what? That's amazing.
Yes, decades ago.
Yeah.
Girl, I was designing collapsible water tanks for the troops. And so that was my first business trip. It was nothing exciting. But anyway, that's my connection to Little Rock. And my first music conference where I was like on the Big Willie panel was in Little Rock. They brought a huge music conference about 15, 16 years ago to Little Rock. And so okay. I came out there to speak on that. So 2 trips to Little Rock in my whole career.
Oh, wow. Okay. Little Rock is pretty lit, right? Especially
if
right
you say
now.
So.
Yeah.
Girl, I actually ended up in Monticello. Is it Monticello? I think it said Monticello, Arkansas.
Oh, Monticello,
is that what?
Arkansas,
yes. Yes, so I had to go there too.
Oh, really? Okay. Yeah, that's outside of Little Rock.
Yes. Yeah. But yeah, Little Rock, I mean, I got the cutest boots ever at the mall in Little Rock, so that part was lit.
Do you know if you went to McCain or Park Plaza back in the day? They had the
boots. I don't know. It was so long ago, but I know I wore those boots off and on for years, and I would get so many compliments. I was like, I bought them in Little Rock.
Right.
So, okay, so you are only girl, four brothers, your family's musically inclined, mm-hmm. so you really, it was a natural progression into music for you. Is that what you're saying?
Man, it was natural. I mean, you know, according to my mama, she always told me I was making up songs when I, you know, three diapers and bottles, you know, and I really feel like I got that from her because, like, when it came to, like, just daily living, she had a song for everything. Even when we was finna get a whooping, it was a song for that. It was
funny.
A song for cooking. It was a song for going to the bathroom. It was... You know how I learned how to spell my name, my phone number, and everything? My mama taught us, like, she basically made up songs for us to learn, like,
wow.
our name, how to spell it, our phone number, our address. So it was, I mean, man, I have to say, wow. like, when it comes to musicianship, my daddy, you know,
okay.
he plays every guitar. You know, the bass, the acoustic, electric, mm-hmm. and everything. And he can sing, but I say this a lot. He play a lot when he try to sing. But my mom, she's the real, like, singer, like,
she's the truth.
Writer. Yeah. So, like, I mean, it's just always been something. On top of, you know, it being in my family, I really feel like it's a natural gift from God to be able
yes.
to, you know, just explore the, just... It's hard for me to explain because I'm so passionate about it, but I don't know. It comes natural for me because it's something that I just love so much. And I mean, I really believe that there's, you know, purpose and healing in music. So, I mean, it's definitely a lifestyle. It's definitely a feeling for me. You know, I can't speak for everybody in the world, but, you know, it's definitely a feeling for me. So it's an everyday part of my life, you know, when I'm able to do it, of course, you know, not every day is perfect, but man, it's a way of life.
First two things. One, you sound like you can sing. You know, some people just have a voice. Like, can you sing a little something? You know, you have that voice where you sound like you can sing. Like, some people can blow, but they don't sound like they can, so you caught off guard. But you sound like you can sing. When you talk, it sounds melodic. You know what I mean?
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
And two, I want to know how many instruments you play, because I saw this screenshot of you with like four different instruments. So I'm like, how many instruments do you play?
Well, my main instrument is the flute. I play the flute. I mess around with the piano, the acoustic okay. guitar, the bass, the electric. And, you know, I mean, I'm not, you know, the best bass player in the land, but I can play the guitar, the bass and electric, you know, well enough to make you some pretty dope melodic songs. So I thank God to even be able to do that. And as time goes on, I can only get better. So it's just really been a man, just the process of developing, growing and investing in myself and, you know, really just not so much worrying about money first, but just having a passion yes. for it mm-hmm. is what has brought me to where I am now, where I can say, you know, thank God I have what I need to do exactly mm-hmm. what I need
yes.
to do. You know, I'm
going back away.
You know, so, I mean, I'm thankful. And on top of that, God bless me, you know what I'm saying, with a husband that is supportive of my
Amen.
Dream. Shout out to Brian.
And shout out to... Oh, that's so sweet.
Huh?
I said, that's so sweet.
Oh, yeah. I got to shout him out because he's such a huge part of, you know, me staying motivated and mm-hmm. staying encouraged because, you know, I have my days and I have my times where I do get discouraged sometimes. Mm-hmm. And also, yeah. I have to shout out Richard Murphy, who is
yes.
my manager, agent, you know, and we're working together to really just mm-hmm. build this thing up. You know, he's really been a strong presence with, you know, helping me navigate the industry and learn more about it and mm-hmm. Network and just he's been supportive. So I'm a three team artist. But, you know,
Rich
like,
is a dear friend. I don't know if you knew that, but Rich is a dear friend of mine. And so he ripped me out like, that's my girl. How'd y'all link? I was like, I keep my ear to the street. I hear yeah. I hear music. So
I know,
but he's a dear
right.
friend.
Ears to
he
the
is a homie. Yeah.
That's dope. I was excited when I found out that y'all was connected. I was like, man, that was divine.
It was. And so, yeah, he is the homie. I love Rich to pieces. And so we've been friends since hello. He was like, you dope. We're going to be friends. I was like, we are. So we met. I think Charlie was on tour, and Charlie Murphy was on tour, and one of my artists was featuring for Charlie or something, and we were sitting on the side of the stage, standing on the side of the stage, talking the whole show, and we were friends after that, since then.
That's dope. That's dope. I mean, he's definitely a lovable person. He know I love like a big brother, and man, I'm just thankful for him, you know, his time, his guidance, and, you know, advice. Mm-hmm. Going forward, I can't wait to see what we, you know, where we go. You know, I really don't speak too much on it because, you know, I'm still working and creating some things that I'm getting ready to share. So, but hey, it's out there now. So, shout out.
I mean, you just gotta keep moving. You don't always have to tell everybody everything you're working on. You know, sometimes you just go make your money. You know what I mean? You ain't got to tell IG about it. You just go make your money. You know, they'll figure it out.
Right.
So people feel like nowadays they got to say everything on social media. You really don't.
I am so horrible because, like, I'm not even going to hold you. I'll be on Facebook. I'll post something, then go delete the app because I don't like wasting my time. I don't want to be on there, you know, not being productive. You know, I only go on there when it's a purpose behind what I need to do, you know. And then I am on Instagram because a lot of people tend to reach out to me more on Instagram for business and things of that nature. But man, I sometimes I gotta put that phone down because I gotta get this music done.
Social media feels overwhelming to me, maybe because I'm old, but social media feels overwhelming, and it feels like another job, and I don't know how my clients do it. I have so many social media sensations and friends who are, like, have millions of followers. I don't understand what y'all are doing. Like, it's a full-time job, I don't understand it.
Yeah.
You know, I post and go to bed, so that's probably why I don't get it, but... they constantly thinking of creative stuff to put up, which I think is amazing. But that's, I mean, I came up in the age where it was relationships and real life.
Right.
It wasn't a virtual reality where you're looking for approval from people who don't know you. So this is foreign to me still on some level, you know, where I'm looking for adulation and likes from people I don't know, you know, will never probably come in contact with, where I'm used to being in real life connected to people, you know. It's been 26 years. So there was no internet when I started in the entertainment industry.
Making it happen for real. Yeah. Not saying that social media isn't a grind because the world has evolved and, you know, I mean, with all the stuff that's been going on, that's one of the, you know, excuse me, main go-tos for people that conduct and work their businesses, which, you know, big ups to that, you know.
Yeah.
But it's crazy because when you think about it, like what you were just saying, like, you really had to be out there in those streets grinding 24/7, you know, moving artists, moving comedians, moving whoever, you know, you're dealing with. And it's some real footwork involved, you know. I come from the footwork era myself, you know. So, like, getting used to social media and adjusting, it was different for me, you know what I'm saying? I'm an introverted person anyway, but I still love people. You know, I'm where it's necessary for me to be. If that makes sense, you know what I mean? Because
I'm an introvert too. People just don't believe me
because
I work in a public. I was like, I've been in this house all day getting ready for my client show that was right before this, getting ready for this platform. Haven't even turned on TV. That's how dope I am and how much I enjoy my own company. I'm a total introvert.
Man, I'm dope. Chi-Town, dope. Yeah. But I mean, you know, I don't know, you know. I could say that social media, I got a love-hate relationship with it.
Because,
I mean, I like to be on it and you know, network and talk to people. But at times, it can be overwhelming for me, especially, you know, I get a lot of, I get a lot of DMs, you know, and I try to redirect people concerning business to my email or to, you know, or to Richard or Brian. You know what I'm saying? Because when you're independent or when you invest in yourself to the point where you actually truly do everything on your own, and then you try to manage communicating with a whole lot of people at one time, it can be overwhelming. So you do have to really lock in and prioritize. You have to have a schedule. You have to keep that mental health right, because if that mental health ain't right, in that physical body, you know, whatever's going on in the mind gonna follow out through the body. So you gotta definitely prioritize and keep everything on lock.
Balance. You gotta find balance in life. Exactly. You know, when I was younger, I was working on so many things. I think I've been a go-getter since, you know, college. Yeah. And so my pastor said to me, he said, you gotta define how you work. You got to define your schedule. He's, I do one thing a day and I don't let anybody dictate what I'm going to do on that day. For me, I adapted what I call like the box theory. And so I put everything in a box, like everything that's family, work, project, individual, everything's in a box. I open up one box at a time. And you can't tell me which box to open up first, and don't touch my boxes. So that's how I stay mentally organized. I compartmentalize everything mentally. Right. And I'm like, I'm working on this, I'm working on that. And I don't let people dictate my schedule. Mm-hmm. You know, I just started producing something for a rising client, and people were telling her when they wanted to be on her platform. I was like, no, you set the schedule. If they can't make it, they can't make it. Right, you don't get in the habit of people telling you what your schedule is, sweetheart. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that happens.
So that's how you go crazy.
Yeah, but I fully understand that. You know, it can be a little bit frustrating, and especially you know, when you this humble kind of low key person, and people don't really know that you are who you really are, that you do all that you really do. And I'm not tooting my horn. I'm telling the truth, because you know, that's everybody when they're dealing with different people. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. It can get overwhelmed. That's why I got Richard Murphy and Brian Bennett Emancipated Talent on here to
you got the right people. And shout out to Lee T. Hart. He's assistant to my friend Justin Hires, actor comedian Justin Hires, and they have their own podcast that they haven't invited me on yet. But shout out to him.
Hey, shout out to you.
Go ahead, sweetheart. You were talking about you having the right team.
Yeah, just, oh man, you definitely gotta have people, you know what I'm saying, around you that are just as passionate about your journey, your give, your goals as you are.
Yes.
And I mean, and that alone, that alone has helped me to grow.
Yeah.
Because I'm telling you right now, it's been so many times that I just wanted to say, you know what? Hey, I'm finna sell every piece of
you just feel like throwing your hands up. I feel like throwing both my hands up a lot of times. But people don't believe it because you're pretty. You got all your teeth. You know, people tell me I'm easy on the eyes. I got all my teeth. They don't believe you have hard days when you got all your teeth and you deepen on the eyes. They don't believe you have hard days. I feel like throwing my hands up all the time. Yeah. I don't let them see me sweat.
We are first.
And so I think that is the disconnect. But when you find a team or some people who just love you and believe in it more than you do sometimes, because there are times when you need to be uplifted. Right. And they got to be the strength of what you do. And so that's an extreme blessing. If you find that in this lifetime, personally and professionally, it's a blessing.
It is. It really is. I mean, they say all the time that you have to have something first in order to be managed. But you also have people out there that truly believe in you, and they'll invest time, they'll invest, you know, their network, they'll invest, you know, even money, you know. But I mean, I'm just so thankful, man. I mean, and I'm not looking like I don't need 100 people. I don't need 100 people right now to do what I do, because thankfully God has blessed me to be able to do what most of the time takes a large team to do on my right. own. And it's mm-hmm. and the reason why I feel that he has, you know, me to do it the way that I'm doing it is for my mm-hmm. own growth. Because when right. I tell you, I think I told you that, you know, I fight lupus. You know, that's an everyday yes. battle, you know. Mm-hmm. I smile through it. I fight through it some days, not so much. I'm not going to sit up here yeah. and hold you in front on you and lie like, because I'm a human being. Mm-hmm. But when I do have them days, I got people like my husband, Brian. I got people like Richard. I got people like my parents and my siblings that encourage mm-hmm. me to keep going, keep putting in yeah. the work. Mm-hmm. Even though stuff is not, you know, may not be, you know, we make plans and we put stuff on time frames, but it don't always carry out how we plan it. So, man, mm-hmm. it's a lot of trust in God. It's a lot of hard yeah. work. It's a lot of mm-hmm. Long nights. You know, say late nights and early mornings, because, you know, when you working for yourself and you literally invested in yourself and build it from scratch, it started on a piece of paper. Like, man, you tend to value things more that you worked mm-hmm. hard for or been through a lot. You know, if somebody just give you some, you're not going to value it as much, because you didn't have to go through the trials mm-hmm. and tribulations to build your resilience and understanding and growth in it. So mm-hmm. when I tell exactly. you I have grown, and I'm just so thankful mm-hmm. for the growth. Yeah, it's definitely a lifestyle. Like Richard just said, it's definitely a lifestyle. It's not something yeah. that I just wake up with my smartphone and say, I'm an artist, so I'm going to do music today. No offense to the youngins yeah. doing that.
It's offensive. You can go ahead and offend. It's offensive.
Let me
quick shout out to Clint Coley, World Series of Poker comedian, very funny. Supreme Rock the World family, one of my besties, Tony Rock, family in the house. So thank you. Yeah, but it is a lifestyle, like Richard said. But yes, what you just said, yes, it's offensive when you are working and grinding and have serious talent and someone decides, you know, with their iPhone that they're going to be a superstar tomorrow. So, you know, about anything.
The crazy part is it happens a lot.
It does. You know, but you can't stop, because I mean, it's cliche, but I really believe cream always rises to the top, right, you know, and right. I think that the pandemic was indicative of where true talent lies, you right. know, because I was like, I'm going to watch these people burn out with their 15 seconds of funny. Live, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And so they're 15 seconds of talent, or they're 15 seconds of creativity. And you start to see them burn out. They're regurgitating stuff that they've been saying for the last 2 years, because they don't have anything to keep it going. To me, when you're truly creative, truly talented, God gives you a never ending stream, and it's right. flowing through right. you. And right. so you're constantly reinventing, constantly expanding, constantly becoming the better versions of yourself. But when you're an empty bucket, it's going to show up eventually. Right. You know what I mean? Exactly. And so I just think that that's what the pandemic was indicative of, right. you know?
Right. And I mean, it sadly, it's true. You know? Mm-hmm. It's no shade. It's no shade to nobody. It's just that, you know, what's in you is going to come out of you. And mm-hmm. if I was to give any like younger artists or creators any advice, I'd tell them, when it comes to like music and writing music, mm-hmm. tell the truth.
Right.
Because the truth is going to last forever. I don't think that me, myself as an artist would be, you know, I don't believe that I would last or make any leeway trying to be like Cardi B or be like, you know, the next yeah. artist. Because it wouldn't be me. If you stay true to who you are and just do you, you know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? People going to receive that natural. They're going to receive you being just you. You know what I'm saying? So right. I just say, man, don't keep up with the trends all the time. Yeah, it's cool yeah. to do trends every once in a while. But you got to mm-hmm. really turn up for yourself. If you trying yeah. to make it, if you trying to, you know, get exposure, this, that, and the third, why not mm-hmm. put all of that energy that you put into doing this challenge and that challenge into your right. own self? Do something right. creative. Exactly. You don't know how mm-hmm. big your stuff gonna get. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I think sometimes people goals. Yeah, I think sometimes people don't realize that their journey is so unique and tailored for them. And it's not going to look like anyone else's story. Exactly. And people love to repeat how this person made it. I remember when I first started in the music side of the industry back in the late 90s, you know, and people were constantly telling the MC Hammer story and this and that, and sold 50,000 out his trunk and they filled their trunk with stuff. And I'm like, what's wrong with you? You know, that's his journey. But I mean, people are constantly looking at other people trying to emulate their story of success, and you hasn't happened yet. Your journey is unique. It's not going to look like anything you've ever seen before. And the other thing you said about, you know, driving yourself, I always say I spent 26 years trying to blow my own mind, period. I don't look at anybody else. You know, and that's what my career is predicated on. And that's what I would tell any young person who's trying to, you know, achieve or expand or even develop a signature, whatever it is you do. And it's going to have to be signature for it to stick.
Right, right. Exactly.
You know, exactly. I wanted to ask you about the lupus and the health issue. I had one close family member who battled lupus, but I have a couple of friends who have lupus, and I believe Nick Cannon has lupus also. I know the Nick Cannon family as well. So what was that diagnosis like? And I think it's such an unknown condition or disease within our society as Black people. I think it's more prevalent with Black people, correct?
It is, and in women, Black women.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, so it's a double gotcha. No, I'm playing. Yeah. You know, you got to keep the humor in, you know. Saying,
you do. You have to find reasons to smile.
Ma'am, I'm sorry.
I said you have to find reasons to smile. I was trying to adjust my earpiece because I was hearing a feedback on my side, but go ahead.
I'm sorry. Is it me? Is it me?
I don't think so. I think it's me. I don't know, but I'll be okay. I'll adjust.
Okay. But yeah, I mean, the diagnosis, I have to say that it was pretty hard for me. Mm-hmm. I mean, I had issues when I was a little girl, you know, and as a little girl, I was misdiagnosed. And, you know, coming up with that, you know, I was diagnosed with alopecia when I was a little girl. You know, and as I aged, I started getting, you know, new symptoms like the butterfly rash across my face and all of that. Mm-hmm. And once that started happening, of course, you know, you start getting more blood work and everything. So, you know, this is kind of hard for me. It was when my grandmother passed in 2018 that stuff was already going crazy, and I was having a million doctor's appointments, and they were trying to find out what was going on and everything like that. Come to find out, you know, they told me that I was misdiagnosed as a child and that I pretty much have had lupus my entire life. You know, it was only until my adult life that it just got at times incapacitating. You know, I was, you know, incapacitated at times. You know, I was even... A lot of people don't know it, but I was even hospitalized for a while, you know, and bedridden.
Wow.
So that's how you know God is real.
Yes.
No, you know, I was even incapacitated to that point, you know, and I don't know, you know, not to be on it for too long. I apologize because it's a long story.
No, take your time. It's fine.
The diagnosis was hard because at the time I was grieving, I you know, my grandmother was transitioning, you know, rest in peace to her. Her birthday is actually Valentine's Day. And then right after that, I lost one of my best friends in a car wreck. So if anybody has any familiarity with lupus, they know that stressful events and traumas can trigger bad flare-ups. So, you know, all of that death back-to-back-to-back and just getting the confirmed diagnosis, it was really hard to, you know, kind of get back to a place where I can function like a normal human. So I had to sit out for a little while, which was, you know, I was you know, working, schooling, music, everything all at once. So it was overwhelming, but God was with me the whole time.
Yes.
Which is what I'm getting to, which is why I'm trying not to get emotional. I'm such a
people get emotional on my platform every week.
I'm trying not to get emotional. I'm such a sensitive person. My heart is just like this big, you know. Not that it's all good in there, because you know I'm a human, and
but that's what people connect to, that humanness about you, the love, the sincerity. I mean, I think that's what people connect to in general when they really fall in love with artists and personalities. They fall in love with that unfiltered sincerity, something relatable. You know, right. If you seem completely perfect, they think you're above them, you know? So when, you know, you have real tears, and when you've gone through something, it touches people on a different level. And that's just my belief, you know? And I think that's why people love you. I think that's why your fan base is continually emerging and growing, and it's going to be sincere and organic. Wow. And it's going to begin to grow exponentially, you know, because of who you are. And they're going to tell people, and they're going to tell people, and that's how it's going to grow. It's not going to be that sensationalized BS of social media. It's going to be people who truly love you and tell people, and then 10 people tell 10 more people, and then 10 people tell 10 more people. Now you have to 10,000, and now you're up to 20,000, and you know what I mean? And so it's going to grow exponentially and sincerely and organically for you. I just see that. Well, you know, so don't be afraid to show people who you are, whatever right. level you're comfortable with, you know, because right. that's the part they're going to love about you.
Thank you so much. Well, thank you for thinking that I'm organic. I'm so country. You got to forgive me. I'm a Southern Belle, so I'm so.
I tell people every show, my mama's from Waynesboro, North Carolina, home of the Color Purple. That's how country I am. And okay. So look it up. Color Purple was filmed right. in Waynesboro, North Carolina, Anson County. That's how country I am. You're Purple Fields. And you know.
So you're from the South then?
Yes. And so my mom's from Waynesboro, North Carolina. My dad's from Fayetteville, North Carolina. They've been together 60 years, married 55, met as teenagers, then went to wow. NCCU, and that's have amazing. Been together ever since.
That's amazing. I mean, that's, yes. now that's what
Deep
I'm talking
South.
About. That's amazing, for real.
Yes. But, so go ahead with your Southern accent and,
I tried
and your recap. But no, I mean, to take it off your plate, like, I didn't understand that when my cousin was battling it, you know, and I think a lot wasn't understood, you know, because she succumbed to complications. Right. And that was years ago. But she was older than me, and right. I looked up to her. I was in her wedding. But the person she met before she married, like a rebound, if you will, was the one that broke her heart. And I think mm-hmm. she really had issues before. You know, and mm-hmm. that stress level triggered it. Like, she flew out to Atlanta, caught him with someone else. Who? I don't know. Oh, caught him with someone else, realized he was living a double life. They had been together for like 7 years. It was like her high school sweetheart. And they were already wedding in motion, you know, and she just decided to surprise her fiance. And she spiraled. I mean, it attacked every organ, because lupus can attack every, what's it called? Every system in your body. It can attack, you know, your nervous system. It can attack, you know, your epidural. It can attack, you know, all of that. Mm-hmm. And so it attacked everything, you know. That's and so I sorry. Literally saw her start to spiral and get extremely ill, drop weight. I mean, had a nervous breakdown. You think it's a nervous breakdown. It's probably attacking the nervous and central nervous system, mm-hmm. you know, and the brain.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was a lot. So I understand the emotion that goes behind that, and right. what stress can do to exacerbate on extreme levels, like what she went through.
You know, and one of the challenging parts about it is, you know, it's a person with it, you know, people that don't know much about it tend to not mm-hmm. think too much of it. They be like, oh, right. she mm-hmm. all right, she look good. She must feel good. Yeah, that's not the exactly. case. A lot mm-hmm. of people don't understand when a person has lupus, they're actually, you know, sacrificing. When they come out, when they move around, when they do things, they're actually, you know, putting on a face, because, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. you know, there's overlapping illnesses that develop from yes. lupus, like kidney failure, heart disease, brain mm-hmm. cancer, you know, fibromyalgia, which mm-hmm. is something that, you know, when the weather get bad, when when you know your joints and stuff just tend to inflame and get flared up, you can't, sometimes you can't even walk. So you know, when you're a person like me that has such a huge passion and purpose, you have such a huge passion for something, and you know that it requires you to work hard at it and put in a lot of time, that's where some of the discouragement comes in at. But because it's also a double standard, because since you do have this passion and purpose, it's like God gives you this crazy strength out of nowhere to still accomplish things, to still get things done, to still press through, to still, you know, supersede the expectation of, man, I just can't do it today. Sometimes you just say, forget this. I gotta do this. and it's like, when he gives you that strength, it's like he continues to give you grace and mercy through it all.
Yes.
You know, that's really, I mean, that's really a huge part of my story. Like, I'm just, I feel like I'm not getting nowhere at times, but, you know,
but
like,
it's bigger than you. It's bigger than you. In those moments, you got to realize it's bigger than you. God's plan for your life is bigger than you. That miracle he's working through you is bigger than you. You're not supposed to see it. Because if you did, you would think it was about you. Instead of about the impact that he is destined for you to make.
Right.
And so it's not about you. It's not about your talent. It's that predetermined impact you're going to make on lives everywhere. Right. And you don't need to be part of the whole process. Because you get in the way.
Exactly.
Like, just be present when God tells you to be present, and everything else will fall in place.
That's so true. I appreciate that so much, because, I mean, you know, when you're in the midst of something crazy, you tend to forget about, man, I'm still here. You know, so I'm just thankful. I'm, you know, it's been a journey.
Sometimes you're too close to your blessing to see how blessed you are.
Wow.
You in the middle, when you're in the thick of it, when you're in the trenches and you think you're trying to figure it out, it's really already been figured out, but it's, you think you're part of the process. You think you're part of the process, so you're in the trenches, but it's already done. It's already done. When you look up, you're where you always imagined you would be, and sometimes beyond your expectations. It's already done, you know?
I
try to remind myself of that.
Yeah, you're so right, because that reminds me of something that I always try to keep in my mind and heart, is that you have to put, like I say it all the time, you got to put feet to your faith. You have to put in the work, you know what I'm saying, in order to activate that, you know, what is predesignated for you. Because if you are being stagnant, if you aren't, you know, at least pursuing what you know's to come, you might not know how big or great it is, then you're not gonna get to it. So that's what I always just try to keep in mind, is just to keep going, you know. So I'm so blessed.
I pray every day. I'll be like, God, help me keep going.
Right.
Help me keep moving. You know, because some things are harder than others. You know, because when you have your own companies, you're in charge of so many other people, so many other things. There's so many moving parts. And I mean, it's a constant prayer, like, God, keep me motivated, you know. And sometimes I don't feel like getting out of bed, to be honest, but people wouldn't guess that, you know, because I'm always trying to smile and be encouraging and blah, blah, blah.
You got a crest whitening smile too. It's so pretty.
Thank you.
It is. It'll make you blush. It is, though. It's a beauty. You have a beautiful smile.
Thank you so much. But you know what? I found, CJ, that God sends angels when you need them the most, when you need an uplift, when you need something. I mean, I believe that's what the Bible means when he says God will give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. And so I remember, not to tell a long story, but I remember I was at my lowest. I mean, like, it was about 4 or 5 years ago. And I mean, I was in a dark place, the darkest place I've ever been. Like, I wanted to give up everything. And I felt, I mean, I was just crying. I couldn't shake it. I've been trying to shake it for days. And I woke up on a Sunday morning at my absolute lowest. I couldn't even think straight. I was so low. And I was crying. I felt like, I guess I was like the kind of Sam Cooke, you're tired of living, but you're too afraid to die. You know, you know, it's too hard living, but you're too afraid to die. That's where I was. You know, and my phone vibrated. And I was like, it irritated me because it took me out of my darkness, the vibration of the phone on my leg. So I looked at the phone. It messed up my pity party. the phone, and it was George Wallace. And he said, God will take care of you. Put some praise on it. That was the text. And I was like, we don't text each other. You know, we have each other's number. We don't text each other. So I said, Mr. Wallace, is it blessing for me? And he was like, yes, Char. And I was like, I don't know how he could possibly know. And so it's like 2 years later, because clearly I made it through my dark moment.
Right.
2 years later, I stopped by the tour with him and Tony and some more and all them, and George Wallace is there. And so he said, come talk to me. He said, you work too much. And so I went into it where he and his friends were eating and stuff. And so I said, I don't know if you remember, Mr. Wallace, but you text me like 2 years ago. I said, but I don't even think you know. I was at my lowest point. And I said, I was ready to give up on everything. And your text gave me enough encouragement to hold on one more day. And he's like, I remember. And he said, that's how God works.
Wow.
And so you just don't know who is watching you. You don't know how God's going to move. God always sends angels. Even when you feel like you're by yourself, even before you had your husband, even before you had Rich, God was sending angels to uplift you at those lowest moments to keep you to this day. You know, and so that's what it means when it says God gives his angels charge over you, keep you in all your ways. It keeps you from falling. It keeps you from giving up before the race is over. And that's what it means. And God's always going to keep you, baby.
Thank you so much. Well, I appreciate you. You an angel, because I really appreciate the encouragement. It's definitely on time, you know. I haven't felt like I've been in a dark place as of right now. You know, I ain't going to lie, like I ain't been there. But you know, I like I said, you know, life is a roller coaster full of ups and downs. And, you know, sometimes things happen unexpectedly, you know, like... Mm-hmm. You know, recently losing loved ones and stuff like that, it takes you a little second to get out of the grief and get back on track. So thank you so much for your encouragement. It means
thank you so much.
Than you know.
you meeting you and having this conversation with you, I'm honored, because I was just floored by your talent. Shout out to Rodney Perry Live, my brother, my friend. He supports everything I do. We support each other, but I just love him to pieces. But I wanted to ask you this before you go. Is there anything, what's coming up, and what is one thing you would want people to know about CJ, the artist, and what is one thing you want people to know about CJ, the woman?
What's coming up? Music on top of more music on top. No, I do have a lot of music coming. And Big Rich gone with me, because I was so supposed to send him an email. But anyway, I do have a lot of music coming. I'm doing a full project, but I'm gonna drop a few singles before then. But It will be this year. I don't have a set date yet. So, I mean, I don't know, man. I'm kind of like, I'm one of those artists that once upon a time, I was like, I need to make sure that I do this right here on this cycle. And if I don't, then, you know, but then I started to realize that why go when everybody go? Because everybody's going at the same time. So just go. Whenever. So I really, you know, the beauty of being independent is you can move how you want to move. You can, you know what I'm saying? Anyway, I got a lot of music coming. You know, I've been working with collabing with a lot of artists behind the scenes. And I'm just looking forward to what's to come from this new music that's coming, because if anybody has heard my older music, I have a project called The Overture Volume 1. When they hear the newer music, they're going to hear the difference, I feel, you know. And I'm not, you know, boasting or anything. I'm just saying that they're going to hear that I'm more open with them. I'm not just on the surface no more. I'm telling you the absolute truth. And whether or not you'll be able to relate to it, you know, everybody go through something. You know, some people relate, some don't. So it's going to reach who it needs to reach. Also, you said tell you something about IAMCJ the artist.
One thing you want to know, you want people to know about CJ the artist. One thing you want people to know about CJ the woman.
The artist. I'm very humble, but I really had to come to a point of realizing, you know, true humility, and sometimes being humble, you can kind of dumb yourself down too much. And it's not to say I'm the greatest and I'm better than everybody, because I don't compete, I create. I don't look around and see what they doing. I just don't do it, you know what I'm saying?
I don't compete, I create. That's right. A whole message. That's a whole word.
I just put in the work silently. I mean, and you know, when it's time for it to come out, people will see and understand. But I would say one thing about me is I realize that humility is, you know, I'm humble unto God. I know who I am. I know who I am as a person. And when I say that I'm humble, and when people compliment me, I always say many humble things. But it's not to say many humble things, I'm all right. It's many humble things in the sense that I'm a human. And look, let's just be real. People can have it all one day and it could be all gone the next day. So you gotta keep that humility, because if you don't, you're gonna get ahead of yourself a little bit.
Yes.
So I just one thing about me that I believe a lot of people know is that I'm humble as an artist. I mean, I'm also humble as a woman too, but one thing as a woman, I'm very I used to be like very tomboyish because I had like a lot of brothers.
And yes.
Coming up like that, you know, I wanted to play football and stuff like that, but I still had the girliness too. But I'm very womanly. I'm very, I don't know what to say about myself. I'm getting nervous.
Now you're blushing.
Right. I mean, it's so much. I mean, what can I say? As a woman, I don't know. What can I say? I don't know what to say.
Well, I won't put you on the spot, but you are an absolute doll. And I enjoy speaking with you. I enjoyed the energy behind all of your DMs. I was like, oh, she's so sweet. I could just feel your southernness. And shout out to Lynette King. She's a sweetheart. Rising actress as well. You just have this whole, it's your aura. And I think that comes across in whatever you do when it's sincere, you know. So my prayer is that you will continue to actualize and achieve everything your heart desires, and that God will continue to blow your mind exceedingly and abundantly above what you could even think or pray. And so I just really want the best for you. I want you to continue to touch lives and continue to be an example of what God can do. And that you are not your circumstances. You are not your health. Right. You are what God created you to be. And you're going to continue to excel and just make people smile all over the world. And I'm so proud of you, love.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you. Thank you so much for having me. Like I said, it's truly been an honor. And I've enjoyed it thoroughly. I feel like I'm talking to my homegirl.
Well, that's the way it's supposed to feel. And I'm honored that you felt that way. And it is. Stay in touch with me. If there's anything I can do, you know how to reach me. And I just want to say, you know, guys, follow me. I have great shows on Thursday and Friday nights on Just One Thing, life-changing moments, always great conversations, always amazing people like beautiful CJ here. And this weekend, we got live from Munich, a special show, 4 p.m. on Saturday, live from Munich, Germany. She has an amazing story, the woman that's coming on. And tomorrow night, I'll be back here at 8 p.m. I'm Charmel McMillan. Just One Thing, Foreword by Mike Epps. Check out the book too. Have a blessed night.